Well, speaking of massive change, our cousins from across the pond have tried to undergo a massive change, or at least some of them have, with Brexit. And Liberty Nation's managing editor, Mark Angelides, a Brighton himself, is in the country, and I managed to sit him down in studio for a talk about what really is happening with Brexit. Sort of see these headlines passing through and don't get a sense of what's really going on, what's the future. We have a special guest on The Uprising, Mark Angelides, managing editor, LibertyNation.com, and resident of the United Kingdom. Cheers, Mark. Say something in British to the people, if you would, please.
Top of the morning to you.
That's exactly what we wanted. So I wanted you, you know, I was reading a Brexit article the other day, and I just legit thought, where the hell are they with this? Why isn't this over now? Even if they went back on it, why isn't that over? And so I just wanted you, because I know that in addition to just happening to being a resident of the country in question, you also follow the issue closely.
Sure do.
And so I just wanted you to give everybody a thumbnail sketch, an uprising thumbnail sketch. What's happening with Brexit right now?
Okay, the Brexit cliff notes.
Yes.
All right. So, well, in 2016, Britain voted to leave the European Union, not to leave Europe, which many people.
No, we understand the difference. Yes.
Put that in, but
sadly,
leave the European Union. Now, the important thing to remember here is this was the largest democratic exercise that has ever taken place in one of the oldest and grandest countries in the world. It was the largest
referendum.
It really
right.
was.
How many people voted, roughly?
17.5 million plus 16
okay.
million. So quite a lot.
Right.
Which is more than ever voted to elect anybody to anything, ever voted on any subject, ever.
Right.
And so what happened was that obviously the Prime Minister at the time, Dave Cameron, he resigned. He handed the reins over to, whoever was to be elected as the right. leader of the Conservatives, which ended up being Theresa May. And then she, with the permission of Parliament, activated Article 50, which is the mechanism by which you can extricate your country from the Lisbon Treaty, which is what binds together
right.
all the 28 countries. Now, this should be a standard thing. It gives you 2 years to negotiate a deal. Now, you don't need a deal. Here's the thing. You don't actually need one. You can just leave. The 2 years is a maximum time limit. And then almost nothing really happened for about a year and a half.
Because she didn't move on it, is that right?
She basically didn't move on it, yeah. Now, there was, I assume part of that was she was hoping that some of the Project Fear scare stories would come true and then people would, on
the mass. So just
demand,
for the people who don't know out yeah. there was a sort of, it was a surprise win in some sense.
It was
the powers that be did not think it was going to win. And then after it did, they were trying to introduce sort of buyer's regret to some significant portion of the population with these scary stories that they wouldn't be able to buy a piece of Swiss cheese in the future without being a member of the EU, and that they would then somehow gin up a second vote or enough popular support to somehow go back on the plan, right?
That was exactly it.
It
was called Project Fear because it really was an unthinkable thing that people would vote against the government's recommendation, against civil service recommendations,
sure.
against celebrity recommendations.
The people who know, sure.
And
when they go against the celebrity recommendations, that's when you know
and
that things
all,
have really gone bad.
Against Barack Obama's recommendation.
Untenable.
We got 2 points for the Brexit side. The day he
right.
turned up and says, you should stay in the EU.
Right.
Our side, we got 2 points.
I bet.
We got a 2-point lead on that. But some of the scare stories that they were putting out was, people would not be able to buy sandwiches. We'd
sure.
hit instant recession. Sandwiches.
Mm-hmm. The Earl of Sandwich was a bright
one.
I think you're okay there. Panini, though, you may be in trouble. So let's catch up. Nothing happened for a couple of years. They didn't actually move forward with an agreement. And then what happens?
Well, now then the 11th hour began approaching. 29th of March. This year. And so Theresa May put together, she said that she put together what's called the withdrawal agreement.
Okay.
Which is a series of different treaties and trade arrangements with the EU to try and limit any economic issues that may occur from interruptions in trade, interruptions in what are they called, like trade route and one of shipping routes and things. But she put this deal, this withdrawal agreement deal, which many people now believe was actually written by the EU because it doesn't appear to have been written by anybody within the cabinet. So she put it towards Parliament and it was voted down. It was the biggest single defeat that any British Prime Minister has ever faced in the Houses of Parliament.
Okay.
It was just removed. And so she, through some other legislation, she got the arrangements to the permission to go back to Brussels and try and renegotiate, which she tried. And then she came back with supposedly an actual change to the legislation, the withdrawal agreement legislation. And here's the thing, the most important part of it is, as it stands, the withdrawal agreement,
right,
if that goes through, Britain can never fully leave the EU without the EU's permission.
If under the current terms of that agreement that she has negotiated,
yes.
Right. So, and why would anybody agree to that?
Because the majority of parliamentarians
don't want to leave.
Exactly.
Yeah.
They want Britain to be tied in. So anyway, it came back, and her own Attorney General, Geoffrey Cox, said...
They can't get those paid trips to Brussels four times a year if it's not part of the EU, right?
Very true. Her own Attorney General said, well, this actually isn't a legally binding thing that gives the UK permanent permission to leave when they choose.
What do they call that guy, though? He's not
Geoffrey
called
Cox. No, he's called the Attorney General.
Oh, really? That's the same? Okay. Yeah. Usually the names are a little different for the
It's a slightly different role, but he is the Attorney General.
Okay.
Yeah. And he came out and said that this is not a legally binding piece of legislation that we can tack on. And so now she's come back for the third vote. So it got voted down a second. And she's coming back for a third one. But the Speaker of the House, John Bercow, he's now said that unless it's a substantive change, you can't, within the same parliamentary session, reintroduce the same thing. So either what's going to happen now is there's one of two options. We're going to leave on the 29th of March with no deal whatsoever, which is the majority-favored position.
Is that your preferred position
at
this point?
That is my
preferred position. That's the way
you think?
Okay.
But it's also the majority preferred position of the British people.
Okay, and what is that... Why is that significantly different than leaving with some deal, let's say with terms that are not particularly odious? In other words, what is the main difference between leaving with, quote-unquote, with a deal and with no deal?
Well, here's the thing. With the deal, the EU and the courts of the EU and the EU Commission would still have a say in how Britain sets certain taxes.
It's more still control and influence. Is there any positive for the UK?
Yeah,
If there is a deal instead of a no deal situation?
Uninterrupted trade.
Oh, okay. So no new deal. I see what you're saying. Yeah. There's not that break where now we have nothing in place that we have to then solution for.
Yeah, actually, oddly enough, the no deal Brexit, as they call it, is not a no deal Brexit. It's World Trade Organization Brexit.
Right.
Which I know Donald Trump's not a big fan of. He thinks that's terrible terms, but it does allow you to...
It's
just
free
trade.
It's free trade. It's great. That's because Donald Trump doesn't understand trade and doesn't understand free trade, or he does, and his understanding that's even scarier. It's one of those things where it's like, is it better if he does understand it or that he doesn't? I'll give him the benefit of the doubt and say that he doesn't, because we know for sure, history tells us one thing, that if you want people to be free and rich, you give them free trade. Or they demand it themselves. I mean, there's a reason why Hong Kong was Hong Kong. It's not an accident. There's a reason why the United States was the United States. It's free trade.
Yep.
It's not about resources or anything else. Trade makes men rich and
gives women
them freedom. Yeah, I say men globally, Mark. Thank you. That's how we do it over here, right?
You
not
go.
Your
you
sexist existence over there. All right, anything else on Brexit that folks need to?
The second option.
Okay.
So one is we leave with the WTO terms.
Uh-huh.
The second one is the scary one. And this is that we get locked in to an extension under Article 50. Now, I believe it was Donald Tusk of the EU who said that you can have an extension to Article 50, which gives us more time to do a deal, and that's going to be 4 years.
Mm-hmm.
And that's just too much. The British people are not going to stand for it.
Well, no, you're not going to take 6 years to get divorced from somebody.
Yeah,
I mean,
absolutely.
It's untenable. Okay, so what is the very next? We're recording now on, what is it, Wednesday, March 20th at 1:52 p.m. Eastern Daylight Savings Time. What's the next time event that we're waiting for in the Brexit process to look at?
We're waiting to see before the 29th two things. One, if Theresa May can somehow get a substantive change to her withdrawal agreement,
right,
and then bring it back before Parliament.
Okay.
And number two is she'll to actually extend Article 50, she needs the agreement of the 27 other member states.
I see.
So I know I suspect, and it's certainly been bandied around a bit, that Mr. Nigel Farage, Mr. Brexit himself, is doing what he should be doing as a member of the European Parliament, which he is. A lot of people are saying, why is he going around talking to foreign governments? That sounds like collusion. But this is his job. He's a member of the European Parliament. And so he's trying to get them to block or to veto, because it only takes one veto from one country to say, no, we're not going to extend Article 50, at which point we leave
right
with no deal, or all the WTO terms.
Right.
So to see whether the 27 other...
Is there one country that you think is more likely than another to veto that?
Well, for their own interests, most of the countries would probably want UK to stay in, but there are several countries that are quite Eurosceptic, or their governments are quite Eurosceptic. I would say Matteo Salvini, the deputy PM of Italy...
So maybe the Italians,
maybe.
Well, maybe I'll make a call. You know, I do have I've got the 23andMe proving I have some Italian DNA going on.
So friend of the friends,
we'll see if that,
and you've got 23andMe to prove it.
Thank you for the update, and maybe we'll get another one before you leave these United States.
If I still can, you know, depending on if the borders shut down or the EU sends the army in.
We'll help them get you out. We know we're very, very pro law and order. You know, last week I gave a plug to the Liberty Nation's newest podcast.
Yes, you did.
The Rabbit Hole, Politics and Prose. And I will let you right now to thank you for coming on The Uprising. Give your own plug. Give people a 10-second thumbnail sketch of what it's about and why they should listen and how they can go find it.
Great. Thank you, Scott. Well, it's about history. It's about books. It's about legends. It's about myths. And most importantly, it's about how these all tie in with politics today and how they affect you. It's a rambling saga through the corridors of time leading right up to the present day and things that are happening in politics.
It makes you feel smarter when you listen, at least for me. So there's that, too.
It makes me feel stupider, but that's because I write it. No, I'm kidding. It's great. Listen to it.
All right. Subscribe. Cheers. Thank you, Mark.
Thanks, Scott. Bye-bye. Take care.
That's it for this week. Thanks for listening. LibertyNation.com. Like, comment, and subscribe. This is Scott DiCosenza. Bye-bye.